I'd like to say good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made, and let us be happy and rejoice in it. God has brought us through 7 months of another year. And this is the first day of the 8th month of this year. So we all give up to God all the glory and all the praise.
Amen.
At this time, we are ready for our call to worship. Would you stand, please? Our call to worship this morning is coming from the book of Psalms 9. Psalms number 9, verses 9 and 10. Psalms number 9. Verses 9 and 10. Does everyone have it?
Amen.
The Lord also will be a refuge for the oppressed, a refuge in times of trouble. Let us read verse 10 together.
They
that know thy name will put their trust in thee, for thy Lord has not forsaken them that seek thee. At this time, we're in the hands of our minister of music.
Thank you. also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. Then said they unto him, where is thy father? Jesus answered, yea, neither know me nor my father. Do you know me? Do you have known my father also? Verse 55. Together.
Yea,
55.
Yeah.
Good morning.
It's kind of hard to get up and give announcements after Mr. Glenn. I mean, we are blessed and grateful to be here to see August 1st, 2020. Reverend Haynes, to our fellow members of Nebraska, and to our fine members of the community. I was asked to do the announcements this morning, and I was only given a couple things, so we're going to left up for an answer to him. We need to be in prayer for Mrs. Johnson, her family. Her mother was late to rest on yesterday. We're in Texas, so y'all continue to be in prayer for Mrs. Louise Johnson. And prayer for Sister Dinkin and Chris Washington, their daughters in ICU. Please continue to pray for her, Demetrius Michelle Washington. Also, Reverend Hilton blessed with his fifth grandchild yesterday. His name is Montre Hart. He weighed 3 pounds and 5 ounces. Priscilla will be going home today, but baby will be in the hospital for a few days as he was in NICU. Is doing a back school event. There will be more information on that. I didn't get a birthday list. I know we have a couple this month, in the next couple of days. That's Ramona Shepherd.
The church say amen.
Amen.
Say amen again.
Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. We will give praises to our God for another privilege to come together in worship. And we are so happy to see all of you present. Why don't you give God some praise for this choir? And singing their hearts out, I lift up 2 people in the soprano section, sounding like a whole choir by themselves. Solicit your prayers for all of our sick and sitting. Sister Barry Johnson lost her mom and she was buried on yesterday in Greenville, so that once you continue to solicit prayers for her, you know she is battling stage 4 cancer herself. And she's really struggling and she's a really, really, she makes me proud to pastor her. She's a very brave lady and we just thank God for her spirit, her bold spirit, and her persevering. Even in times such as these. Sister Priscilla Hill gave that baby up finally Friday. It was spoken on Wednesday. They took it Friday, and it's like a month or something early, but they had taken so that she didn't get messed up. And baby's healthy, she's healthy. Baby needs to stay a little while, but let's just be prayerful. It makes you feel better. Baby has big feet. I saw a picture, man. Baby got a picture. We'll leave it right there. We do praise God for God being God and all that He does for us. Pray for Shay. Shay contacted COVID-19, and Mom texted me yesterday and put her in ICU. So y'all pray. And let me just say while I'm on that subject. Because she didn't get a shot. And so she contacted COVID-19. While I was announcing about Shay, had another number, another hard-headed number in the class, Bible study. Said she hadn't had that shot, and ain't gonna get it. Let me tell you something. I'm gonna tell you like I told her, I will bury you.
Yeah.
I keep a black suit handy. When you wanna die, I'll bury you. But it doesn't make sense. When you have a vaccine to handle the problem, and you're too crazy. crazy to get one. I mean, I know some of y'all Republican, y'all like Donald Trump, but you all not be that crazy. That you have a solution and you want to avail yourself of that solution. Please, man. And it's free. It's not costing
you. It's free.
It's not like you know you got to pay money for it. It's free. You don't need insurance. All you need to do is go get the shot. Please. Please go get the shot. I got enough to do without going to funerals that we don't need to have. Please go get the shot. Go get the shot. If you're going to commit suicide, get you a gun. Shoot your hand. Don't do that. Go get your shot. If you don't have the shot, get the shots. It's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. I understand. I know the history. You know, I know about, you know, Tuskegee and all that. But we ain't talking about all that. We're talking about you getting a shot. Please, ma'am, and please, sir, get the shot. Children under 12 can't get one. So we need to stay healthy so we can help them to be healthy. See, the bad thing about you around here, you might get it and survive when you kill somebody else.
Right.
Please, ma'am, please, I'm begging, pastor's begging you. Please get the shot. I feel like the Lord is telling me to tell you, please get the shot. Bible study, we just finished up with 1 Kings. Sister Joanne Johnson asked me if we were going to continue for all of Bible study. We are going to continue to 2 Kings this coming Wednesday, 2 Kings chapter 1. So if you want to do a little heads up, get ahead of the game, you can start studying chapter 1 in 1 Kings, and we'll continue our study in Bible study. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Today is August the 1st, so my birthday is officially over. It was a good birthday. I had a good time. I want to publicly thank again all of you who contributed to making my birthday what it was. Had a really outstanding time, and we praise God for you and for your spirit. Love can really help you last longer. And when you have a positive attitude, life is so much better than when you have to deal with a lot of negativity. The Lord has blessed me. In these latter years, I really deal with mostly positive. I don't deal with a lot of negativity. So I just praise God for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I'm a happy guy.
Amen.
When your birthday?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow? Oh. You're excited? Sunday, I thought my birthday, before my birthday, she wanted me to come down to the front to make sure I'm here. It's right there. You heard me. Come on down. Pardon?
Your birthday was
my birthday was the Friday before. Thank you very much. I really couldn't care less. I don't care if it was Saturday. She got to come down to now. Come on down! The third. Come on, baby. Come on down here. That's Sister Jackie Ross. Sister Jackie Ross. Very sweet lady, very sweet lady. And she has pretty legs, pretty legs. I gotta tell the truth, I gotta tell the truth, I gotta tell the truth. I can tell you some other stuff, but I don't want to do that. Somebody else said, my best belief, don't need to find out. Thank you.
Lord, I just say thank you for all the little blessings that you bestow on us. The ways that you bless these times and often be obedient in your kingdom. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Times and often.
Jesus, to bring here, to live in the land of Canaan.
us, listening ears, Lord, let your word touch us. Prick our hearts, our minds, our souls, our spirits, Lord. Be convicted and convinced, converted, Lord. Help us to leave this place better than we came. Lord, we want to be more like you. We want to walk like you and talk like you. So, Lord, help us to grow in your spirit. Help us to grow in your grace. Help us to grow in your love. Let your words wrap us. That we will be better manifestation of your word, will, and way. We ask these and many, many other blessings in the magnificent, mighty, miraculous, marvelous name of Jesus the Christ, your Son and our Savior. And the saints of God said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Our thought for today comes from our Lord's Gospel, recorded in John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Our Lord's Gospel is recorded in John chapter 8. Starting at verse 17. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one that bear witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me. Then said they unto him, where is thy Father? Jesus answered, ye neither know me nor my Father. If ye had known me, you should have known my Father also. Jump down to 55. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say I know him not, I should be a liar like unto you. But I know him, and I keep his sayings. Quickly turn to Psalm number 7. Psalm number 7. Psalm number 7. Verse 11. God judgeth the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. God judgeth the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. I got a question for you. Do you know God? Do you know God? You may be seated. Looking at the morning news, I was frustrated. It was too much like the news the day before. I started flipping through the channels while I was flipping through. Saw the Olympics on one channel. I didn't want to see that because there are too many politicians messing with that. And I changed the channel. I saw the House had a session. Police officers, the Capitol. Officers were testifying for a special committee. So I don't want to see this because it's politics and they won't be bothered, but I was slowed down by the testimony of one of the officers. The officer there that day was Harry Dunn, Michael Fandom, Aquilino Gomez, Daniel Hodge, and then of course there was the officer that died on January 6th. Well, he didn't die January 6th, but the energy he sustained on that insurrection caused his death. The testimony of these men touched me. Listening to them, I was driven to tears. Even how it affects me. I think it's safe to say, Coach, I was angry, upset, These men put their lives on the line. These men was fighting as though they were in a battle.
Right now.
Not doing police work, but as though they were soldiers on a battlefield. Yeah. They were literally fighting for their lives. It's the same injuries that many of them are dealing with right now. Had to go to the hospital. Some of them brain damage. One man was messed up. His foot was just torn up. They had pictures of the foot while it was trying to heal up. One fellow, the boy Fainan, he was really upset. He was not really a capital officer, but he was called to the scene and said when he got there, he was shocked. He admitted he voted for Donald Trump. Said he wasn't really a politician. You couldn't say he was a Democrat or Republican. But he said he was just there to do his job. Before he knew it, he was fighting this crowd. He is in awe that these so-called Americans are taking flags, United States flags, and literally pounding them with them. Said he hit him on his head several times and punished him. He was so messed up, he had brain damage. But he said he was kind of out of it when they knocked him on the ground. He realized somebody was trying to take his gun. He was fighting to get his gun. And he realized his gun was gone and somebody was out there. Kill him with his own gun. Kill him with his own gun. Said when he heard that, he figured it was all over. He says, I have children. Thinking that just mentioning the fact that he was a father might give them enough sympathy to spare his life. Some of the better of the crowd grabbed him and pulled him away from some of the others. Said he finally they pushed him and brought him to the door where the policeman who was on the other side of that door pulled him in to spare his life. But he said the greatest tragedy wasn't just what happened to him. The greatest tragedy is that the men and women that he put his life on the line for was acting as though nothing happened. So it was just a misunderstanding. They don't even want to call it an insurrection now. Donald Trump was quoted that same day and saying that it was really a party. They really had a good time, but that the media ought to let out all of the news because they're holding back on the good stuff. If you could see all the footage, you would know it was good. They asked the policeman, do you think it was a party? You think it was a good time? You felt any love? One officer said, that love almost killed me. You can see the anger in their hearts from the fact they weren't just willing, they literally put their lives on the line to save the life of people who are lying about what happened that day. I was struck. I've seen tragedy, I've seen hardship, but not just the pain, Brother Dickerson, of seeing people hurt. It was the insensitivity of people who are in power.
All right, come on now.
Who are more concerned about their own political gain than they are about telling the truth. I'm sitting here and saying, this is the kind of world we live in. Wasn't just those politicians, wasn't just those Republicans, but we got the news media who like to cover stuff over. It's a joke to me. ABC talking about sending in those news articles or news concerns you have, and they're going to find the truth about news. I say, how are you going to find out the truth when you're part of them spreading the lie? But they're all in cahoots that man was in power for 4 years. And a lot of folks said nothing. And it's sort of like some people think that you can just make up stuff.
It's almost like they don't realize we all saw that day.
Yeah.
We were looking at it.
Right.
You don't need a news reporter to tell you what you're looking at.
Right.
You saw how they went in those people's offices. You saw politicians under the table. Some of the same folk who said nothing happened, hiding like a bunch of little. And people putting themselves on the line for them.
Yeah.
And then you have the low-down gall to get up to a camera and say nothing happened.
Yeah.
That's the kind of world we live in. That's the kind of country we live in. And we need to understand that God is not pleased. That's why I read that thing. God gets angry with the wicked every day. See, some of y'all think anger is a sin. Anger is not a sin. Anger is an emotion.
Right?
It's an emotion that God expresses.
Right.
And God is upset with the wicked. But my question is, do you know God? Because it appears to me if we are the children of God and we are the people of God, the things that angers God should anger us. Well, I have a witness here. I won't take you long. I'm feeling the sermon. I just had to get it off my chest. I want to start talking about the wronged warriors, the life and the lying leaders. I was teaching the other night about Ahab and how he had 450 prophets lying to him. And only Micaiah was telling the truth. We're living in the land now. It's not just the prophets that are lying. Seems like everybody lying. It's like, you know, they lie like it's nothing. Like you can lie and the truth is supposed to vanish because you got control of what's happening. Listen to the news. When the last time you heard a person call that thing that happened January the 6th an insurrection? They got a new name for it. The event, they talk about what happened, but they want to put the labels, they want to put, we're going to rewrite history and make history what we want it to be.
Yeah.
Black folk ought to know something about that.
Oh, yeah.
That's all they do with us.
Yeah.
That's why we don't know our history, because they were so busy rewriting history. Yeah. We can't discover what the truth is.
All right.
Do I have a witness here?
Yeah.
But God loves the truth. And God's people should love the truth. Brother Trump acts like a spoiled brat. Like he was raised having his own way. Like a little child, you tell him don't do it, he said, yes, he said, no. Then you're going to no. And just make up anything. And that's supposed to make it better.
Yeah.
How you going to come up and tell me you don't see what you see? You see what I say. In him was the Bible says that John was writing on an occasion when Jesus was dealing with this, kind of the same thing. It's in that 17th verse when Jesus made a statement that got the attention of his enemies. He says, my judgment is true. I'm not alone, but I am the Father, and the Father sent me. It is written that the truth can be established by two witnesses. Jesus, in other words, was using their law against them. Well, John picks this up, and John is trying to show us something about the Christ. That whatever else Jesus is about life.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is about light. It started in chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then when you get to verse 4, it says, and the Word was life. And the life was the light of men. Yeah, the Word was life. That's what I'm talking about. The Word was life. That what the world needs now is life. That's why you got kids wanting to commit suicide. They don't have life. When you put your confidence in the wrong stuff, you're willing to end your life because your life is not worthwhile. Jesus said, I have come that they might have life and they might have it more. Come on here, somebody. Brothers and sisters, the church needs to do a better job of spreading life in the world. The church needs to do a better job of spreading hope in the world instead of pointing to a lot of negativity and telling everybody how they ought to look and how they ought to dress. You need to tell them what life is all about. There is no life without Jesus. And Jesus in a life can make a world of difference. Do I have a witness here? In him is life. And this God representatives are those who speak life and speak truth. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was life. In the beginning was the Word. God's Word is life. The problem, I hope you would rather you'd rather run your life with your opinion. You'd rather run your life with what you think it ought to be. You'd rather run your life according to popularity, but that's not life. Real life comes from the Word of God. He's life. He's what makes life worth living. It's all right to come to church, but that's not the key. Not only do you need to come to church, you need to connect with life. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. I was listening to the choir singing, and I saw y'all clapping and rocking. Oh, man, it sure feel good up in here. I thought about some of those Sundays when it feel kind of dead, you know. When it looked like some folk had a bad night before. I said, you know what, that's not the way church ought to be. Church ought to be alive. Church ought to be a reflection of vim, vigor, and vitality. You can't claim to have a God that is life and live and you walk around looking dead. You can't walk around telling your God is great and awesome and you act like you just lost your best friend. You can't claim that God can do anything, and then when some storm come in your life, you're ready to throw in the towel. I wish I had a witness here. If the hurricane knocked your house down, you don't have to stop living. You can thank God he gave you the ability to see another day. You can buy another car. You can buy another house. You can replace stuff, but you can't replace life. And if you have life, you ought to celebrate life. I'm just glad to be in the service one more time. I'm just glad that he woke me up this morning. I'm just glad he enabled me to see another day. I'm just glad that he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me that I belong. You ought to celebrate life. Celebrate what you have to celebrate. You got life to celebrate. You might not have a lot of money, but you can celebrate life. You may not have a lot of pretty clothes, but you can celebrate life. You may not have a job, but you got life. And as long as you got life and you got job of God, you ought to have some hope. My hope is you. Wish I had a witness. You don't have to worry about lies messing you up. You see, it's sad when leaders start lying. It's sad when preachers start lying. It's bad when the power Bible, let it be lie. But you know what the problem is? No matter how the devil spread lies, truth marches on. I wish I had the women's word. And they tried to fix that thing. Man, they almost turned that thing around. And here, the officers are testifying. These are eyewitnesses. These are folk who experienced it firsthand. You see, you can't stop the truth. The truth will always march on. That's why you need to know the truth. And the truth shall set you free. Yes, it will. You don't need a good memory to tell the truth. See, if you're a liar, you gotta have a good memory. You gotta remember the lies you've told, but when you tell the truth, you can remember the truth. Because the truth is always right there. Do I have a witness here? Those officers needed life, but instead of life, they received death. Can you imagine putting your life on the line for somebody, and the person you're sacrificing for don't even appreciate you? When the reporters went around trying to get the Speaker of the House, for the not the Speaker of the House, but the leader for the Republican Party, they said, he said, well, I was busy and I didn't get a chance to look at it. Other Republican leaders, I was occupied, I didn't get a chance to look at it. The problem being that when they consulted the Republicans, they didn't come up with a spin. You know how they like to put a spin on it? They like to put a spin on it. They put a spin on it to make themselves look good. But it's hard to put a spin on what it transpired. So the best thing they can come up with is, I was busy. Oh, wish I had a witness here. But that wasn't a spin, that was an insult. If I just put my life on the line and I'm ready to testify, and you're so busy you don't even have time to listen to what I have to say, that's an insult. But I put my life on the line and I'm suffering from injuries trying to protect you, and you don't have time to listen to my testimony, that's an insult. I need life. I need to know that I didn't sacrifice myself in vain. I'm not getting life. I'm getting death. Seems like to me I wasted my time. Seems like to me I wasted my sacrifice. Seems like to me I gave my all, but my all is not appreciated. Oh, and you know what? That's really what the walk with God is all about. You got to learn you don't sacrifice for the folk you sacrifice for. You sacrifice because God says it's right to sacrifice. Hey, I found out. Some of the people you've done the most for are the first ones to criticize you and talk about you. But you know what I found out? God is faithful. And if you stand with God, God will stand with you. Not only do I see wrong warriors, life and blind leaders, but I'll see also see the witness, the light, that there's always going to be a witness.
Yes, sir.
Light shines in darkness. That's what it said. The light shines in darkness, and the darkness can't be. The darkness comprehended it not. That didn't mean the darkness can't see it. Man was talking about his airplane ride. He said, you know what? I was in the air. And I noticed in the air, I don't care how small the light was, you could look down and see the smallest light all up in the sky. I said, that's why they used to tell them to turn all the lights out so the enemy would be able to drop the targets or drop the bombs on them. Because I don't care how high they were in the sky, they can spot the light. Because you can always see a light in the dark. John is not talking about being able to comprehend in the sense of being able to see light. He's talking about the darkness could never defeat the light. The darkness could never beat the light. That you need to understand, once you are light, you're on the winning side. When I'm light, I need to give witness to the light. darkness can't defeat the light. And they needed light instead of stuff they received. They didn't really get it in light, they got darkness. You know what? That's what's wrong with the world. The world is around looking for light. And too often the church is shoving out darkness. You read this chapter, it starts out when they brought that woman caught in adultery to Jesus. They won't kill her. We caught her. We didn't just catch her. We caught her in the very act. I wish I had a witness here. They had blood in their eyes. They were ready to wipe her out. But you know, Jesus got the right on the ground. I wish I had a witness here. Now, that's what I'm talking about. I don't understand it. How is it that we claim to be the church of God, the hand of God, the extension of God, but seem like we have more viciousness in our heart than we have love? When you start talking about a riot, oh, we get excited. When you start talking about a lynching, we get happy. When you talk about stoning somebody, we can celebrate that. We don't mind pointing our finger to point at somebody else's faults, because if I keep pointing at your faults, you don't have time to point at my faults. They were ready to do her in. You know the story. How is it going to catch a woman in adultery and come back with one person? You know, back then they said, well, where was the man? Because nowadays you might not have to get a man, you might have to get, but that's another sin. The fact is, they only came with one person. Jesus right on the ground, and when he stood up, he said, you without fault. You have no sin. I don't know what he thought. I heard more preachers theorize when he wrote on the ground. Someone said he was writing incidents where they had messed up themselves. Remember on the corner of Celia and St. Jude? 6 o'clock one Friday night, and then he just raised up. And they start looking and remembering, you know. He didn't tell what time, see, they were all at the same place, different times, and they started backing away. When he looked up, finally, there was nobody there. And he asked the lady, where are your accusers? Do I have a witness here? Yeah, those men love to find out wrong in somebody else. Jesus said, well, you know what? He says, your law says if you got two witnesses, the truth can be established. In other words, in Deuteronomy, says you never could convict a person on the testimony of one person. You had to have at least two or three people. And he said if you had two people, you could establish the truth. You want to have a witness. So the Bible said that they didn't have a lot of folk, but they said, we don't need another witness. We caught her in the very act. And when Jesus got through with them, they all had to walk away, because they were all guilty of what they were trying to accuse her of doing. Understand that guilty don't mean necessarily that they did the same thing. Guilty means they were guilty of sin. They're going to tell you, you got to be careful how you deal with other folks' sin. Because what you do to others will be done unto you. The world is in darkness, and the world needs to see a light. They don't need to see more darkness, and somebody needs to witness for the Lord. Those men shared the light of the truth in their testimony, but in the midst of their light, they are talking in a dark situation. In other words, I wouldn't be standing here if they didn't have the courage to tell the truth. Right after that, some people trying to ostracize them, calling them liars and all kind of names. I said, boy, that's kind of bold to call police officers liars. When we all saw what happened, and they said they were telling the truth. How is these folk who claim to support the blue? They're always behind the blue. They don't have a problem with the blue when the blue is knocking something aside your head. But here they are trying to kill some of the blue. I wish I had a witness here. I would wake some of y'all up and fall for some of this garbage. You see, it's not about blue and black and white. It's really all about their personal agenda. If I can just have my way,
yeah.
To hell with everybody else. Do I have a witness here? Well, they knew. Jesus said, you know the law. But the problem is, you don't know the God of the law. You know the law of God, but you don't know the God of the law. He's talking to people who knew the law by memory. Pharisees and scribes, Sadducees, they knew the law well, but they didn't know the God of the law. They could quote the scripture, but then he couldn't quote what God said all about it. Oh, y'all better hear me today. I keep telling you, private folk coming to church quoting a lot of stuff, but you don't know the God behind the stuff.
Yeah.
It's one thing quoting the word, but there's something else when you know the word killer. It's something else singing a song and with the right words, but you don't know the one who composed the song. You need to know God. You don't just need to know what he said, you need to know him. You don't just need to know about him, you need to know him. You don't need to hear me preach about him, you need to know him for yourself. Now, there comes some situations in your life, life can get dark, life can get drear, but if you know him, he can see you through it. You can't call pastor, but you'll be able to call on the Lord. Say he called me. I didn't answer the phone, but the good news is that when you call me and I don't answer, you can call on him.
Yeah.
And he'll always answer you. You can call him in the morning, call him in the noonday, you can call him at 4 o'clock in the morning, and he'll always be right there. Do I have anybody here to witness that? He will make a difference in your life. He will answer your call. Somebody said, I called on him.
Some ever ready.
Because ever ready ain't ever ready. Do I help with it? I love the Lord because he's my power source. When the Lord is a power source, he's ever ready. God is a power source, he's my light source. So since he is my light source, I don't have to worry about darkness. I can just walk in the light. Do I have a witness here? If I connect to him, I can just live in the light. If I walk with him, I just have the light all inside of me. It doesn't matter how many switches you turn off, I still got my power source. Do I have a witness here? Well, my brothers and sisters, you are a witness to the fact that there is a light source, and that light source is God. Let me let y'all go. Not only do I see the wronged warriors and the witness, the life, and the lying leaders, the light, but I also see the Lord. Does no good for me to tell you about a light source if I can't get you connected to that source. No sense in me telling you about life if you can't avail yourself of that light yourself. It's all right talking about you can get it, but preacher, I need some instructions. How do I get in touch with this God? You ask me, do I know God? How do I get to know him if I don't know him? Jesus says, I know him. Yeah, because he and I are one. Jesus says, I know him. And if you need a witness, he said, I witness for him and he witnesses for me.
Yeah.
I wish I had a witness here. He said, I know he's truth because he is the epitome of truth. Right there, I love John, man. Because see, if you fast forward over to John 15, somebody asks the same question. Yes, he says, show us the Father, and we'll be satisfied. Jesus said, do you know the way? I got some mansions. I'm going away. You can come. He said, how are we going to come when we don't know the way?
Yeah.
He said, have I been so long with you that you don't know what the way is?
Yeah.
He said, I am the way.
Yeah.
I wish I had a way. I am truth.
Yeah.
I am the light.
Yeah.
He that cometh to me, he got to know something about the way. One fellow said, show us the Father, and it suffices us. He said, have I been so long with you, and you don't recognize who I am? I am the Father of one. Show us the Father. And if you show us the Father, we can see the way. He said, when you see me, you've seen the Father. When you see me, you've seen the way. When you see me, you've seen what light is all about. When you see me, you see what life is all about. Isn't it amazing? Folk claim to be representatives of God and they don't even know God. Jesus said, I know you don't know my daddy because you don't know who I am. Yes, me and the Father are one. You ever seen a baby and they can't deny the baby because the baby looks just like the daddy. I wish I had. I talked to a father the other day. I said, are you sure that was my baby? Your baby? He said, oh yeah, I was sure. He said, when I saw the boy, he looked just like I did when I was a boy. That's what Jesus said. Me and the Father look like each other. We resemble one another. We are the same because we are cut from the same cloth. Yes, I am the way and I am life. And if you know me, you'll know the Father. So come on in and meet the Father. We live in a world of ecumenical understanding. Everybody claim to know God, but everybody don't want to know Jesus. Everybody claim to know God, and yet they're not in right relationship with the Son of God. Jesus said, the only way you can get to him, you got to go through me. Seem like to be as bad as seem like to be something wrong with that. Let me explain it to you, Lucy. You see the reason why he's the only way, because any other religion you read about or study, they all have one thing in common. They all have a moral code. That is a standard by which men and women ought to live. A standard that tells you what's right and what's wrong. Yes, but you know what? When they get through with their moral code, it's all over. Because nobody has ever kept the moral code without messing up sometime. And the Bible said the penalty for one sin is that you got to die. But the gift of God is eternal life. And the witness here, the reason why Jesus is the only way is because Jesus paid the price that you and I could not pay. He's the only one that took our sins on him and hung on the cross. Yes. Talk about the Septuagint. If you ever study a commentary, you're going to see a Roman numeral 70. That's the letter L, X and X. Me and know what Roman numerals are. They show it on the Super Bowl. You know, the Roman numeral 70 was for the Septuagint. The Septuagint was the Greek, translation of the Old Testament. One of the kings, he got, translators who were Hebrews, he got 72, and it ended up with just 70, and they translated the Bible, and when they got through translating, they had six different translations done in separate places, but the translations were all identical. They said, oh, it must be a mighty God. They translated the words, and all the words were the same, but they had one word they had problem with. The one word they had problem with was the word atonement. You see, there was no Greek word for the word atonement. I wish I had a witness here. But what they end up substituting for the word atonement is propitiation. That word propitiation is the word they substituted for atonement. It occurred more than 100 times in the Bible. I have a witness here. That word propitiation, you see, it means God is pro and con. Yes, God is for you, but he's also against sin. Yes, he's for you, but he's against sin. In the Old Testament, yes, the representative of God, the priest, had to take two goats, and he would, have them to touch one goat. That means the sins of the people transferred from him to that goat. But then he would touch the other goat. And that means the sins from him were transferred to that goat. Two goats, but they weren't the same. You see, one goat was going to be sacrificed on the altar. The other goat was going to be set free in the wilderness. They called him the scapegoat. You see, when God saved us, he dealt with our sin. That means that there's going to be a remission of sin. There had to be the shedding of blood. If there's going to be remission of of sin. Somebody got to get some blood to deal with the sin factor. But you need to know something else about propitiation. You see, God not only covers my sin, that's what he said, the blood covers me. And for Jesus, blood does more than cover your sin. Jesus' blood will get rid of your sin. Oh. Jesus' blood, he said, it'll separate your sin from you as far as the east is from the west, as far as the north is from the south. That's propitiation. I wish I had somebody that if you know Jesus, you don't have to let the devil keep raising up your past. Man, you deal with something that's past and gone. You want to find my sin, you better try to go catch that goat. He's running somewhere, so we don't listen. But Jesus, he paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin never a crimson stain, but he's washed me, and I'm white as snow. Is there anybody here? No, he can cleanse you of all your sin. Is there anybody here? No, you can make a difference in your life. Is there anybody here? No, that not only can he give you life, but he can give you light. Is there anybody here? No, that he is Lord of lords and King of kings. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And nobody can come to the Father but by him. Is there anybody here who know my Lord? If you don't know him, let me introduce you to him. Go to Golgotha and watch him hanging on the cross with your sins and my sin, a hole in his side, crown of thorns on his head, hung his head in the locks of his shoulder, and he gave up the ghost. They put him in a borrowed tomb. That ain't the end of it. But he lives. is I can't go. But I'm sure of this one thing. Yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. Yes, God is real. For He has won and made me whole. Oh, His love for me. Just like your gold. Yes, God. know, God, nobody can answer that question for you but you. If you don't know him, you don't have anybody to blame but yourself. God has no respect of persons. So that if you will surrender your will in his will, your way to his way, if you will just open up and invite him in, he'll come in and sup with you. He'll eat with you. He'll come in. He'll take residence inside of you. He'll live with you, but you have to invite him in. He doesn't use his power to overpower you. He said, I don't want any unwilling workers. I want folk who volunteer. You can't say, God made me. You got to give up. You got to surrender. You got to surrender all and let him come in. If you're here today and you want to know him, I guarantee you need to know him. In times like these, you need to know him. It's not just black lives matter. They say all lives matter. Well, you know what? When you know God, you know what life is really all about. When you let him come in, wouldn't the world be a wonderful place if it wasn't just cliches, but it was real and people would love everybody? Folk would judge folk on the basis of the color of their skin. Folk would judge you on the basis of how much education you've had or what neighborhood you live in. Folk would judge you on what kind of car you drive, how much money you possess. If folk would just love just because they're loving. See, God doesn't love us because we are lovable. He loves us because he's loving. And he that knoweth, he that loveth not, knoweth not God. For God is love. And if God is in me, the love of God must also be in me. The ability, the capability to love is given me by God. And so if I surrender and let him in, he can change my whole outlook. Oh my God, have you ever woke up and not hate anybody? Woke up and you loved everybody. Even folk who mistreat you, but you still love them. You love them anyway. You love them anyhow. I tell everybody, I love you. There ain't nothing you can do about this. Love is not something that I vote about. It's not something I fuss about. Love that's just his. And if God is in you, the love of God has to be in you. Your life can be so much sweeter, so much brighter, and burdens lighter. If you're here today and you're willing to surrender, you can come to him right now while you have a chance. Oh, my Lord. You're trying to mess with people. Makes you shout, makes you cry.
I can't call by name, but I know that you know them. You know their room.
conditions, Lord God. Work through your doctors, through your nurses, through your medicine, through all your healthcare workers. Work a miracle, Lord God, because we know you're still in the miracle business. You touched our bodies one day, Lord, and we called upon you. And you healed us, Lord God. So we ask you for your healing right now, Lord, if it is your will. But let us also remember that it has to be your will, Lord God. You know what we want, Lord God, but we want what you want, Lord God. So if it's your will, work a miracle. In the mighty name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen.
Let us now prepare for the supper. Prepare for what to receive this commemoration. Our Father, our God, we come again, asking that you prepare our hearts to be obedient to your will and your word. You told us as often as we do this, that it would show forth your death and your suffering. You're cognizant of your suffering. We're mindful of your death. I said earlier, Lord, we realize that you paid a debt that no one else could pay for us. We thank you, Lord, that you are the help and our hope, that you bore our sins so that you can take our sins away. And so, Master, we are walking in the freedom of your efforts, the newness of life. Master, help us as we drink your blood and eat your body, become more like you, to be walking manifestations of you. We'll live like you, and walk like you, and talk like you. We will be spreaders of your word, your will, and your way. Pray, Lord, that I would bless every heart here today, and bless every home here, Lord. Bless our homes to be homes of peace and prayer and love. Lord, let your life just wake up in each of us. Revitalize you in us so that we can energetically, vigorously pursue your purpose and your plan for our lives. We ask these and many, many other blessings in the matchless, mighty, marvelous, miraculous name of Jesus the Christ, your Son and our Savior. Church said, amen.
Amen.
Get those persons in the back, please come down first.
Thank you.
you earnestly and fervently.
That we ask it all.